Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Matt DeSilva, and on behalf of the Board of Directors and the staff of U.S. Lacrosse, I would like to welcome you to the 2017 National Lacrosse Hall of Fame Induction Celebration, presented by RPS, Bollinger Sports and Leisure, and Markel Corporation. I am honored to celebrate with you tonight the induction of 9 great lacrosse players, coaches, officials, and contributors to the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame. To start this evening, please join me in welcoming the 50 current Hall of Fame members who are here tonight to welcome the class of 2017. Hall of Fame members, please stand at your seat when your name is called, and if able, please remain standing until all Hall of Fame members are recognized. Dane Barberi, class of 2004. Steffi Barnhill, class of 2006. Ted Bauer, class of 1991. James Burke, class of 1994. Skeet Chadwick, class of 1992. Jay Connor, class of 1994. Dee Cross, class of 1999. Tracy Davis, class of 2011. Julie Dayton, class of 2016. Betsy Dougherty, class of 2000. Michelle LaFear Doyle, class of 2016. Fred Eisenbrandt Jr., class of 1994. Michael Federico, class of 1999. Ronald Fraser, class of 1987. Michael French, class of 1991. Kathleen Geiger, class of 2001. Mark Greenberg, class of 1998. Josie Harper, class of 2006. William Hooper Jr., class of 1975. Jesse Hubbard, class of 2012. Julie Hull Elliker, class of 2015. Jay Jalbert, class of 2014. Jake Lawler, class of 2011. Skip Lickfus, class of 1993. Sue Lubking, class of 2001. Les Matthews, class of 1996. Jane Miller, class of 2003. Aaron Millen, class of 2014. Robert Miser Jr., class of 1980. Richie Moran, class of 1983. Mike Morrill, class of 2016. Sarah Nelson, class of 2015. Michael O'Neill, class of 1993. Dave Petromala, class of 2004. Tom Postel, class of 1986. Jim Potter, class of 1997. Doug Radebaugh, class of 1992. Willie Scroggs, class of 2003. Tom Sears, class of 2007. Roy Simmons Jr., class of 1991. Vinny Sombrato, class of 1997. Sue Stahl, class of 1999. Dom Starzia, class of 2008. Mike Farrell, class of 2004. Sue Tyler, class of 1999. Joan Wagner, class of 2003. Lynetta Ware, class of 2001. Michael Watson, class of 2013. Jess Wilk, class of 2009. Judy Wolstenholme, class of 1996. It is an honor to have you here this evening. Let's have a round of applause for our Hall of Famers. And now, let us welcome the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame's class of 2017. Please stand at your seat as your name is called. Robin Nye Wood. Don Zimmerman.
Best. You can be the King Kong.
Leslie Blanken Lane.
You can beat the world. You can beat the war. You can talk the guy, go banging on his door. You can throw your hands up. You can beat the clock. Yeah. You can move a
Doug Knight.
You can break rocks. You can be a master. Don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you can find yourself.
Standing in the Hall of Fame. Yeah.
Jim McDonald. Laurette Payette.
The world's gonna know your name. Yeah. And you'll be on the walls of the Hall of Fame.
You can go the distance, you can run the mile. You can
Casey Powell.
Through hell with a smile. You could be the hero, you get the gold. Breaking all the records you thought never could be broke.
Yeah, do it for your people, do it for your pride. Yeah, we're gonna know.
Jill Johnson Redfern. Brooks Sweet.
And the world's gonna know your name.
Yeah.
Cause you're burned with the burn.
Ladies and gentlemen, your National Lacrosse Hall of Fame class of 2017. Before we begin our induction ceremony, I would like to remind everyone that leaving the room during the ceremony should only be done between, not during, presentations if possible. On behalf of U.S. Lacrosse, I'd like to take this opportunity to recognize our current Men's and Women's Hall of Fame nominating subcommittee chairs, Hall of Famers Tom Kiegler and Jess Wilk, and their respective subcommittee members for the important and challenging tasks that they take on each year. Please join me in recognizing these outstanding individuals and the leadership and integrity they have brought to our sport's greatest honor. Tom could not be here with us tonight as he battles a grave illness. Our thoughts and prayers are with him, the Kiegler family, and their loved ones. In addition to making the final selections for the Hall of Fame, the nominating committees also select the winners of the U.S. Lacrosse Lifetime Achievement Award. Initiated in 2015, the U.S. Lacrosse Lifetime Achievement Award recognizes outstanding career contributions and impact to the sport of lacrosse. Primary criteria include accomplishment as a player, coach, administrator, or official, in combination with participation and leadership activities in local, regional, and national lacrosse organizations over the span of a career. This year's award recipients are the late Warren Kimber Jr. and Elaine Knobloch. Kimber was a lacrosse letterman at Hobart College who went on to serve for over 20 years as a game official, chief referee, and district assigner. He then served as the NCAA's national coordinator of men's lacrosse officials and the USILA's district assigning director from 1990 through 2015. The Kimber family was unable to attend this evening, but would like to thank U.S. Lacrosse for honoring Warren's commitment and passion for lacrosse with the Lifetime Achievement Award. Knobloch was a collegiate standout at the University of Delaware and has served as a coach, clinician, educator, and administrator for more than 35 years. She has been an active board member of the U.S. Lacrosse Potomac chapter for nearly 25 years, including 13 years of service as either president or vice president. Please help us to recognize these two exceptional contributors to the game of lacrosse. And now it is time to begin the official induction ceremony. We'd like to begin with recognition of the Hall of Fame members who have passed away in the last year, followed by a video tribute to this year's honorees. U.S. Lacrosse, along with RPS Ballinger Sports and Leisure and the Markel Corporation, presents the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame induction ceremony, celebrating the addition of 9 new inductees who tonight take their place among the all-time greats. Presenting tonight's Class of 2017 National Lacrosse Hall of Fame inductees. A 2-time All-American, National Defender of the Year in 1991, NCAA champion, and later a member of the 1997 U.S. Women's World Cup team, Robin Nye Wood is being inducted as a truly great player.
And anybody that has ever been on a championship team kind of knows that feeling. Even when I watch it on TV now, I can tell when a team has it, and we had it, and it was awesome.
A 3-time national champion as a coach at Johns Hopkins, who also coached for 23 seasons at UMBC and recorded 237 career wins, Don Zimmerman is being inducted as a truly great coach.
I love Mondays after a win. Man, we just came off a big win. Let's get back to playing. Let's get back to practicing. That was a good feeling. And then after practice was over, I got to put them on the end line, which I love to do.
Team captain and MVP at Hollins College on its 1979 national runner-up team, and later a member of the 1982 U.S. World Cup team, who earned All-World Team honors, Leslie Blanken Lane is being inducted as a truly great player.
In All World, I thought that was pretty funny. All World. Where do you go? What do you play? Mars next? But the only reason that I got that award was because of the people who surrounded me.
A three-time collegiate All-American at Virginia, three-time All-ACC player, and the National Collegiate Player of the Year in 1996, Doug Knight is being inducted as a truly great player.
We weren't gonna be okay with losing. We wanted to step up and be the team in the ACC and just sort of whatever happened, we were gonna be resilient, we were gonna come back, and we were gonna continue fighting, forever.
A former player who also served as a youth, high school, and collegiate coach, as well as a longtime administrator with the La Crosse Foundation and the La Crosse Hall of Fame, Jim McDonald is being inducted as a truly great contributor.
What I've done in this game is because of my love for it. I enjoyed it, and it just meant a lot to me.
A nationally rated umpire who has officiated championship games at the high school and collegiate levels and served as an administrator in national leadership roles, Laurette Payette is being inducted as a truly great contributor.
If I have a perfect game, I'm going to retire that day. And I always have hoped that I've done my best at each one and done the sport proud and the officials proud.
A four-time collegiate All-American, two-time member of Team USA, and the second leading scorer in the history of Major League Lacrosse, Casey Powell is being inducted as a truly great player.
And Casey was full of fantasy. He did things that you don't teach. They just come naturally. He's unique. He's a one-of-a-kind player, a one-of-a-kind person.
A two-time collegiate All-American, two-time NCAA tournament MVP, national collegiate champion, and a member of the gold medal-winning U.S. team in 1993, Jill Johnson-Redfern is being inducted as a truly great player.
I think our national championship at Ursinus was a very special moment. To win with those people at that time in my life was, I think, rewarding for them and rewarding for me.
A four-time collegiate All-American, gold medal winner with Team USA in 1982 and an all-world player, and three-time professional indoor league all-star, Brooke Sweet is being inducted as a truly great player.
It just means a lot to me. Got a chance to play with and against all the great guys out there, and I've just had so much fortune that's come from it.
Congratulations to tonight's Class of 2017 National Lacrosse Hall of Fame inductees. Our first inductee this evening, Robin Nye Wood, is being presented for induction to the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great player by her college teammate and friend, Julie Myers. Please watch the screen.
Robin Nye came to Virginia a year behind me, so I had 1 year on the field hockey and lacrosse team at Virginia before Robin joined, and right away we knew that she was a little bit more serious and a lot more grown up than most of her teammates were. She made a huge difference, impact for both teams right out of the gate, and really have just been was her teammate for 4 years in college. So I was actually a fifth year student athlete playing on the lacrosse team when we won our national championship, and in large part because of Robin Nye. Robin is fierce. I mean, she was as strong as can be and as tough as nails. So mentally and physically, there was nobody who was going to beat her. Into a ground ball, on a one-on-one dodge, anything in the air was going to go Robin's way. So she just did a great job of setting the tone. She didn't make any mistakes when she was playing her player or playing that transition game, but yet she was also able to cover for other people's mistakes. So she was that one person that we knew was going to anchor that defense. We were all going to be able to make a couple of mistakes here and there, and Robin was going to be able to clean it up, fix it, and then give us that feedback right after that. Robin was a great leader, and she was a really hard worker, and she was a mature person on and off the field. I think she had to give us a couple of years to match her maturity on and off that field. But once we got there, then we could really kind of buy into everything that she was trying to create for our team. She had some awesome players alongside of her that really helped her do her role incredibly well as well. So by the last 2 years, she was a first-team All-American. She ends up the Defensive Player of the Year, ends up a national champion, and then ends up, you know, finds her way on the U.S. team as well. So, you know, she needed us a little bit, and we really, really needed Robin. To be in the National Hall of Fame, the people sitting in the room tonight and the people that she's going in with, I mean, it's the best of the best. And, you know, I walk around the museum and you see some of the other names that have come before her. And then you think about all the things that she accomplished with being a captain, an All-American, a Player of the Year, a national champion, a world champion. You know, Robin Nye was a natural fit to go into this elite group of people that are in the Hall of Fame. So I was so excited for her, so proud. I think it represents all of the work that she's done and reflects that. And then it's a huge perk for all of her teammates to be able to see one of their best get recognized at this level. I think it's just really uplifting and really exciting for all of us. Robin, congratulations on a huge honor that reflects so much hard work, dedication, and just an ability to play at the highest level and to make it all fun and to bring your teammates along with you. So for all of my teammates and our coaches, we'd like to say congratulations to Robin on this huge honor.
Really awesome. And I am super excited to be starting out this night. So it's a thrill to be here and seeing so many familiar faces. I was on a field trip with my son's sixth grade class at the Franklin Institute in Philadelphia when I received the call about my acceptance into the U.S. National Lacrosse Hall of Fame. There are a lot of things that I forget, but that day, time and place, that moment will not be one of them. This is a truly special honor, and it doesn't come lightly being a defensive player. I am proud of that, and I loved playing defense. I love the competition, the speed of the game, the challenge of shutting down my opponent, and of course, the fact that I got to spend a lot of time with my best friends every day. I'm a very lucky person to have been helped by so many people along the way. In high school, it was not only my coach, Miss D, but officials and coaches from opposing schools like Kay Boyer and Phyllis Kilgore, who wrote me letters of recommendation and urged me to try out for Philadelphia schoolgirls teams. Once I got to UVA, my coaches, Jane Miller and Julie Dayton, showed me how to balance intensity and fun. They were incredible coaches and role models. Two of my most memorable moments of lacrosse came in my fourth year at UVA in the same weekend. We went to the Final Four that May, and during our practice time, Jane and JD had such confidence in our team that they allowed us to play Ultimate Frisbee instead of lacrosse. They knew that we were as prepared as we could be, and it was time to enjoy the moment. Luckily, it worked out for them, and we won the national championship that year. That weekend was also graduation weekend for UVA, so myself and the other fourth years missed the university's ceremony. But we ended up having our own ceremony the Monday after, where we got to walk down the lawn and celebrate with our deans and teammates and parents. That was a great weekend. I just assumed that I would no longer play lacrosse after college, but Jane opened my eyes to the U.S. program and the process of trying out for the U.S. team. From there, it was my U.S. coaches, Sue Stahl, Heather Dow, and Feffi Barnhill, who gave me the opportunity to experience lacrosse at a whole new level. A level where it meant training mostly on my own, learning determination and sacrifice, learning how to play alongside women who had always been my opponents before, a whole new appreciation for the game. My most memorable moment for the U.S. would have to be my last game in my career, 1997 World Cup in Japan. We won 3-2 in sudden death overtime. It was a true team win with everything left on the field. I couldn't have asked for better coaches, better teammates, or a better win. That victory lap was certainly sweet and one that bonded us forever. My teammates, I wouldn't be standing here today without such great teammates. At every level I've played, I've had the honor of playing with great athletes who are also great women and great friends. At some points, it's like we could read each other's minds.
know what the other person was going to do before they did it. Playing with people like Sherry Greer and Kathleen Geiger made me elevate my game. And I could name so many others. I see teammates here from high school, college, and US, and I just want to say thank you to all of them. Teammates for life. My family, they don't get enough credit, so I have to take a moment. All my intensity and determination comes from them. My mom grew up working endlessly on the family's apple orchard and then teaching kindergarten for 30 years. My dad has been inducted into the Gettysburg Athletic Hall of Fame twice, both times with football teams from his years there. My stepmom worked her way through medical school while working full-time and raising a family. And my stepdad played football at University of Pittsburgh and coached football and basketball for years after. And my uncle and my grandfather on my dad's side have both been inducted into the Westchester University Athletic Hall of Fame for football. They all taught me hard work. They modeled it, and they learned to love lacrosse because I loved it. To my kids, my sister, my brother, and the rest of my family, I'm sorry you have to listen to repeated stories of lacrosse over and over again. So thank you all for supporting me no matter what. And thank you to Julie Myers for all your kind words and support over the years, for holding our generation of UVA alums so close to the lacrosse program there. You are a class act. Congrats to the current U.S. women's lacrosse team for winning the gold this summer. Awesome job. And to the other inductees tonight, well done and well deserved. Congratulations to you all. And a final thank you to the U.S. National Lacrosse Hall of Fame Committee for this honor, and also to the staff of the U.S. Lacrosse that worked so hard to put together this fantastic event. Thank you.
One last round of applause, please, for Robin Nye Wood. The next inductee is Don Zimmerman, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great coach by his son, Jake Zimmerman.
I think at a young age, I was always aware that he had a love and passion for it, and it was obviously his career, especially going to all of the UMBC games. I wasn't old enough to watch him coach at Hopkins, so UMBC games are where we went and, you know, watched him coach on the field, and also, you know, I had some opportunities as a kid to go on road trips if, you know, my mom was out of town. But I think where I became fully aware that it's meant something special for him and it was a passion was when I became one of his players. I think I saw it from the outsider's perspective, being at home when he comes home, talks about practice, or I had the opportunity to sit, you know, stand on the sidelines with him during games and, you know, see him in the huddle. But once I became a player, from day one of my freshman year through my final game as a senior, I really saw, you know, how passionate he was and what it really meant for him, not just as a career, but really just the love of his life. I would say that he's very detail-oriented, whether it was the scouting report for any game, knowing, you know, what handed one guy was, and even if they're a goalie, you know, everything was detailed and meticulous. We had itineraries, we had a dress code, we, you know, always, everything had to be on point and sharp. On the field, you know, with practice, we would do drills that would take 45 minutes to an hour so that we could perfect it. And he held only the highest expectations out of us because he's been in moments where he, you know, had the opportunity to win championships and played with teams that had that caliber, and he maintained that throughout his career. So no matter the level of talent that he had, he still held those expectations. If I had to describe like a noun for my father, he's a teacher. I mean, I would say he is a coach, but coaching is teaching. And he's not only a teacher on the field, but he's a teacher off the field. You know, whether he's at home as a dad, or he's playing golf with his friends, or even just coaching in general. And I think what his major focus is, and it's been this way for his entire career, he knows what works and he wants to implement that. I'll run into guys who played for him at Hopkins or guys who played at UMBC in the late 90s who I've always known but never played with, and they would talk about how genuine he was and how, you know, he was a leader. He was the leader of the Wolfpack and he would do anything to sacrifice for his team. Dad, I'm extremely proud of you and the accomplishments that have led up to today. And, you know, I couldn't be more proud as a son, as a former player, but as a best friend to know that you'll go down in history as one of the all-time greats and get to be in the Hall of Fame. I love you, and I couldn't be more proud to be able to present this to you.
Thank you, buddy. That was very special. You're very special. Thank you all. I would like to thank the U.S. Lacrosse Men's Hall of Fame Committee for my selection into the National Hall of Fame. You have helped make a dream come true. Thanks to Lauren Rossi and Ashley Mannion for their time and effort in making tonight a wonderful celebration. You have been terrific. Congratulations to my fellow inductees. It is an honor to share this special evening with you, your families, and your friends. When I received the call from Rick Lake informing me of my selection, I immediately thought of my parents, Jim and Dorothy Zimmerman. They introduced me to the game and provided me every opportunity to be successful. Along with my sisters, Jane and Judy, who are here tonight, we were truly blessed to have such loving and supportive parents. Coaching can be an emotional roller coaster ride. Family and friends mean everything. To my wife, Dorothy, daughter Emily and her husband, David, son, Jake, and his lovely girlfriend, Bridget, you are my best friends. You have been there for me through the good times and the bad. Your unconditional love and steadfast support help make tonight possible. You are in my Hall of Fame. Having balance in one's life is so important. Sharing good times with family and friends away from the field has always been something our family cherishes. Thanks to our extended family and friends for being here tonight and sharing in this special evening. Speaking of friendship, I'm very proud of my relationship with the Japanese Lacrosse Association. Over the past 30 years, it has been exciting to witness the growth of lacrosse in Japan. I have developed many friendships over these years and have fond memories of our time together. Joining us tonight is my dear friend Tak Takasaka of the JLA, along with Naoko Akutsu, who is here in Baltimore doing an internship for U.S. Lacrosse. Takasaka-san, thank you for attending tonight's ceremony. It means a lot to me. I look forward to our continued friendship. Domo arigato gozaimasu. I had a blast playing lacrosse and was fortunate to have played on some terrific teams during my playing career, surrounded by a great group of teammates at every level. My decision to go into coaching stemmed from my enjoyment playing on those teams with guys whose camaraderie, both on and off the field, was something I will always remember and cherish. We had some fun. I learned from some of the best coaches and the best people our sport has ever known. At St. Paul's, where lacrosse was a religion, George Mitchell taught the game and made it fun. Playing for Henry Ciccarone at Hopkins made me realize I wanted to get into coaching. Chick's passion competitive nature, and sense of humor were contagious. His practices were intense, his game preparation unsurpassed. Longtime assistant Fred Smith, we called him Uncle Freddie, he was the man. Freddie was all about the big picture. I cannot think of anyone who made a more meaningful impact on so many. And having the legendary Bob Scott as my AD and mentor was a real asset, not only with the X's and the O's, but more importantly, with life lessons that I try to carry with me to this day. And last but not least, my lifelong friend and mentor, North Carolina's Willie Scroggs, a true innovator in our game. Willie encouraged his assistants to think outside the box and showed faith in us by allowing us to be hands-on coaches. Coach Scroggs also stressed the importance of recruiting good kids from good families. And with this in mind, I want to thank the parents of the players who I coach for entrusting their sons to our care and guidance. Your support made a huge difference and enhanced our team's experience in many ways. It's all about the team. Without the support of my assistant coaches, I would not be standing up here tonight. I've had some of the best assistants a head coach could ever ask for. Hardworking, dedicated men who put in long hours helping make the program better. Thank you for your passion. I am forever grateful for your friendship and commitment. It's been a privilege working together. And while the subject of coaches, I salute my college colleagues, men who, like myself, dedicate their professional lives to the game of lacrosse. It has been an honor going against you and your squads. The thrill of competing against the best our sport has to offer has been challenging and rewarding. You kept us on our toes and made our teams better. Then there are the players, the guys who get out there every day and work their tails off to get better and to make the team better. The game's focus is and should be on the players. They are the ones who get the job done. No coach has ever gotten a tough ground ball, scored a winning goal, or made a huge stop. That's the player's job, and I've had the privilege to coach some of the greatest young men a coach and his staff could ever ask for. To all of my former players, thank you. You made it fun to come out to practice every day, especially Monday. Your dedication and commitment were inspirational. It was so much fun being with you guys through both thick and thin. Lacrosse has given me so much. I am happy to have been able to give something back to the game. With this in mind, may we all, players, coaches, officials, and fans, be grateful for the opportunity to be involved with this great game and to find our own special way to give something back. Be stewards of the game. Always remember and celebrate its Native American heritage. In the words of Faith Keeper, Orrin Lyons, play hard, give no quarter. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Hall of Famer Don Zimmerman. The next inductee is Leslie Blanken Lane, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great player by her U.S. teammate, Ellen Remsen Webb.
When I first met Leslie, when we were on the U.S. team together in 1979-80. And we would travel to Hockessin, Delaware, and she was engaging and funny and just a pleasure to be with. She was explosive. She had such power. Her 10-yard sprint was probably as fast as any sprint I've seen. So with the result that she could get to where you threw the ball. And what I loved is I'd be coming down and I had great players to throw to during those years. When I saw her cutting for the ball, I knew I could fire it because she not only had this explosive ability to come to the ball, but she also had these amazing hands that could catch the ball. So it was like two different elements. She had this explosion from below, but then this kind of lovely grace above. And then she'd turn and she'd place it in the goal. I never really felt like she fired the ball. She would just place it, outsmarting everybody. And I think that's why she went 5 for 5 against Scotland when we were in the World Cup. She drew people in with her humor, with her passion again. And she was explosive. She is an explosive personality. So it all kind of ties together. When she'd play, she would make sure that every player got the ball. I mean, it was interesting how she kind of orchestrated the whole exercise. I've talked about her passion, but there's also always perspective. She never got down. And I think she had that perspective about playing for our country as well, that it was about who we are and how we comported ourselves, as well as how many goals we made. When you think about the people she got to play with, the top players at all these top schools, that's a huge testament to her ability and her selflessness, because people would let her take that spot. She was just a clever, smart, savvy player. And as a result, she made me have to think that way. She made all of us better. She was a injection of, again, she was such a powerful player that it galvanized us. It didn't hurt that she always popped in 2 or 3 goals when we needed them. Leslie, this is so well deserved. And it's my pleasure to be here with you and everybody to be part of this memory for you. Congratulations and thanks for all you've done for lacrosse.
Thank you so much. I wanted to begin by saying how lucky I am to be honored with such a talented group tonight. Congratulations to you all. Your contributions to the game are incredible. So, and thank you to US Lacrosse and everyone who helped to put this evening together. I'm truly honored. There's something so magical about team sports. I've always loved playing and working together with a group of other talented athletes to achieve a collective goal. It's amazing to watch the strengths of some mix with those of others to create this whole entity where, when put to the ultimate test, provide the team with unbridled success when all cylinders fire together. I've been fortunate to have this experience in the wonderful game of lacrosse. I consider myself a we person. Not we, W-E-E, or as my college coach, Lynetta Ware, would say, a shrub. But I mean we as a collective group. You win together, you lose together. My father, a basketball player at the University of Virginia, taught me honesty, fair play, and humility. And he always said to me, Leslie, you may be one of the best players on the field, but you are nothing without your teammates. I've tried to live up to those words with every game I've ever played. I enjoy watching golf, and one of my favorites to follow is Jordan Spieth. He gives such an honest interview, and when he discusses his rounds with the media, he always uses the word we. Never I, but we, as in his team. His team consists, I guess, of his coach, his caddy, his agent, his family, who are all there for him. He may be the one who hits the ball, but it is those around him who make him successful. I feel the same way. I'm truly humbled and honored with this recognition here, but it was those who surrounded me who made me as successful as I am. Be it my high school, college, or US coaches, or the teammates I was lucky enough to play with, they are all why I'm standing here today. On our US tour to Australia in 1980, we won one of the test matches against the Aussie national team by a goal. A coach congratulated me for scoring the final and winning tally. I responded that I would not have scored had Sue Billheimer not made the save and passed it to Ellen Remsen on the clear, who in turn passed it to Linnie Thompson, who passed it to me so I could shoot. Four other teammates scored in that game. I just happened to score the last goal. We all won the game. We all won the game because we worked together to be successful. So I stand here somewhat uncomfortably accepting this amazing award because I firmly believe that my success was due to those who taught me, fought on the field with me, and pushed me to play to a level I never thought I could achieve. I would like to thank Ellen Webb for putting her presentation together with 5 days' notice in June before we went away for the summer. What a teammate you are. My high school and college coaches, Ann Morton and Lynetta Ware, U.S. coaches Jackie Pitts, Josie Harper, Libby Williams, my teammates from Springside School, Hollins College, the Philadelphia club teams, and the U.S. teams, and others who are here to support me tonight. And finally, to my wonderful husband and children, you are my greatest victory. Thank you.
One more time for Leslie Blanken Lane. Our next inductee tonight is Doug Knight, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great player by his college coach and Hall of Fame member, Dom Starzia.
It was my final spring at Brown, frankly, spring of 92, and I had gone over to Westminster School to see a player that was doing a PG year that was coming to Brown. While I was there, I saw this wildly athletic, electrifying little left-handed attackman playing, and I was immediately intrigued. Didn't know anything about him, and then actually, then shortly thereafter, I got the job at UVA, and so I wound up finally get to Charlottesville in mid-August, and Mark Van Arsdale, who was my longtime assistant, was already there. Mark had been at UVA the year before. And he was in the office when I arrived, and I think one of the first things I said to him was, "Mark, I got this little attackman that I really like that I don't think anybody knows about." And he said to me, "Doug Knight." I said, "Wait a second, how is it possible you know about this guy?" I don't think that you ever really think of it as specifically as he's likely to be a two-time first-team All-American. He does graduate as Virginia's all-time leading scorer. You know, I don't think that I was thinking of it in those terms when I saw him the first time, but I'd like to think that when the first time I ever saw him, that initial impression was, boy, there's a boy that's really a really special athlete, has a chance to be a really special player. You know, there was this sort of common refrain. It wasn't based in reality, but what people were saying to us was that you're not tough enough. You know, this program's not tough enough. You know, you're not going to win. You're not tough enough. You know, and you don't overcome it by talking about it. You know, you overcome it by doing things. You know, and it was in Doug's freshman year, actually, in '94. We played Syracuse in a semifinal game, and we're down 5 goals, and we're 2 men down going into the fourth quarter. And we come back and win the game in double overtime. And I can remember some older Virginia guys that had graduated before I got there that said to me, "We wouldn't have been capable of doing that. I didn't know that Virginia had that gear." And it was because of guys like Doug and Michael and other players too, but Doug, you know, that we now all of a sudden we played with an abandon that perhaps we hadn't exhibited enough before. I was always a little concerned with whether or not he might get this recognition in the end, you know, and I always felt like he deserved it. I think, frankly, I've always felt like he's an iconic figure in our game. I mean, people still talk about him in hushed tones. He's very unselfish, just a wonderful guy. He's a better person than he is a lacrosse player, and he was a heck of a player. Well, it's certainly my pleasure to be here today. I'm very honored that Doug would ask me to be his presenter. This is one of the very special young men in my lifetime, both to know personally and to have had the great pleasure to work with. And so I think it's just it's a wonderful evening and an honor for a guy that is well-deserving. Doug, welcome to the Hall of Fame.
Awesome words and providing me the opportunity to experience the University of Virginia, certainly a turn in my life that has shaped a lot of who I am today. Thank you to U.S. Lacrosse, especially Lauren, for putting on this great evening. Congratulations to my fellow inductees, many of whom I knew through my playing career, and then others who I met tonight. It's been awesome to sort of talk to you, learn about your connection to the game. The one person that struck me as odd I hadn't heard of was Casey Powell, though. I'm kidding, Casey. I got a whole page here for you. It was always, psyched that there's a good Syracuse contingent here tonight, because that was certainly a game you circled on the calendar. You knew it was going to be a track meet, and it always brought out something special in me. So, just to watch your career, the longevity of it's been remarkable. I feel an overwhelming sense of gratitude to be standing here this evening, and I'm going to try to sum it up with a letter that I'm going to write to the three most important people, three of the most important people in my life, but it really can pertain to anybody, young or old, trying to find their way. Dear Drew, Owen, and Eli, whatever you choose to pursue, I hope that you are fortunate enough to cross paths with some of the following. A friend for life, like Kev has been to me. Someone you know, that knows everything about you and that you can count on and rely on when you need them. A brotherhood that you build through your younger years and into high school with guys like Cliff J, Curdy, and Bogues. People that you trust and stay in touch with no matter where you are in the world. A calm and cool freshman year roommate like Moho to help you figure things out. A group of amazing teachers, coaches, mentors like Dom, Coach Van, Murph, Coles, Mr. Eck, that show you every single day the importance of hard work and simply being flat out passionate about what you do. A couple of guys like Whitey and Wah that accept you and help you tremendously to get up to speed with what they're doing and push you and inspire you to do things that you weren't sure you were capable of. Or guys like Birchie and Snots, yes, that's his name, who from the moment you meet them make you realize that it's a good thing to be yourself, no matter how out there that self is. A group of amazing teammates or coworkers like Rennie, Melks, Curry, Selbo, Brucey, Tuck, Baruch, Curtis, Rags, McKnight, and Jalbert that join in along the way. Continue to build something after you're gone and take your program or organization to a new level. Parents that love and support you like mine have and are present in your life, but also give you the space to figure things out on your own like my mom and dad have. Siblings that you love, support, and respect no matter what, like Aud and I have and always will. Perhaps more than anything, I'm wishing for that one. Some of these people and experiences you already have in your life, you just need to become aware of them, but it doesn't all come easy. You have to work at it really hard if you want to be good. You have to be willing to be uncomfortable, like standing in a line drill, hoping they don't call catch right when you get to the front of the line. You have to endure injuries or absences, like sitting out an entire fall that might drive you crazy. But whatever is happening in your life, please make every effort to frame it in a positive way. A lot of my personal experiences clearly are focused around sports and specifically lacrosse, but the cool part for you guys is that you get to decide what moves you, what drives you, what you're passionate about, and chase it with all your heart. Whatever you do, please know that there are a lot of awesome people out there that are willing to help. And don't be afraid to extend yourself to them, because you'll find that the relationships and friendships you build over the course of your life provide you with purpose and make you really happy. Love, Dad. Thank you.
One last round of applause, please, for Doug Knight. The next inductee is Jim McDonald, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great contributor by his son, Riley McDonald.
I think for Dad, lacrosse is not about him. It's about the people he's met in the game. And I think that's it. I think he has met so many people along the way that became great friends of his, people who he loved and liked being with. And that, I believe, is his real passion for the sport. You know, he played other sports and he enjoyed them, but he stuck with lacrosse. And for 50 years, he's been involved in the Lacrosse Foundation, U.S. Lacrosse. He's done it because he loves the sport and he loves the people. If you go through Dad's body of work in lacrosse, as a player, he was a good player, honorable mention, All-American. But as a coach, he could have been any kind of coach. He was so good with kids, and he taught the game, he taught the fundamentals. He required discipline, but he made it fun. He made a real contribution to a lot of young people's lives in the youth levels and then on JV and high school. When I heard the slogan on President Reagan's desk, I'll paraphrase, it says, "Show me a man who won't take credit for what he does, and I'll show you a successful person." That's Dad. He never took credit. It was never about him. He did it because he loved the sport. I think he thoroughly enjoyed the process of selection. He loved getting to know the people he was talking to in order to make the selections. He did that 24 years. That was his great contribution to the sport. He won't say it, but entering the Hall of Fame means a lot to Dad. You put 30 years on the committee, 24 as chair, has to mean a lot. But he's so humble, he'll tell you, "I'm really happy and this is great," but he is stunned, he's honored, and you know, it's a big deal for him. Dad, you're one of the great men I know. You are the greatest man I know. My sisters feel the same. You've supported us through your life. You've introduced us to the sport of lacrosse. You've done so much for so many people in lacrosse, getting them started. I'm choking up here because you mean so much to all of us. Congratulations, Dad. You deserve this more than anybody I know. And congratulations on a life and love of the sport of lacrosse. Well done.
Thank you, Riley. Thank you very much for this terrific honor. It certainly is one to be here. The sport of lacrosse has always been good to me. I made so many friendships through lacrosse from this day when I was 12 years old, and my good friend of my father's gave me my first lacrosse stick. That was over 75 years ago, and my love for the sport is still strong. Thank you to all my friends and family and colleagues, and especially my players, for coming tonight. U.S. lacrosse has come a long way from those two rooms it occupied behind the Johns Hopkins gym when Denny Moore approached me about joining the Board of Lacrosse of Fame back in 1964. Denny was a great friend and mentor and a legend in the sport. I just left coaching the University of Baltimore to focus on my insurance business, and we had four kids. I told Denny that it was just too busy to join the board. Denny replied, "If you need something done, get a busy man." I have personally adopted that saying too. If you need something done, get a midfielder. You can pull that one, that really gets them. The sport has come a long way since then. I was part of a team that came with the slogan, "The fastest sport on 2 feet." And today it's true that lacrosse also is the fastest growing sport in the world. I want to thank the wonderful people that I've worked with at the Lacrosse Hall of Fame and U.S. Lacrosse. People like my friend and business partner, Mickey Webster, another Hall of Famer with whom I chaired the campaign for lacrosse in the 1990s when we got built that new headquarters at Hopkins. Plus, all the members of the Men's Nominating Committee for the Lacrosse Hall of Fame that I worked on for 30 years. This process requires a great deal of thought, understanding of the game, and decision-making. We had a great time working together. I have friends here tonight who I played with at Washington League and Mount Washington. I also have players here from the University of Baltimore and St. James Lacrosse, which we founded with some like-minded parents in 1965. For one St. James team alone, we had seven players who became Division I captains. That makes you feel pretty good. Hereford High is represented here tonight, too. We won two state championships together, had a great bunch of people supporting us. And you know what? It was really fun to be part of it. My son Riley played at Cornell on a team that played in three national championships and won two. And his great coach, Richie Moran, is here tonight. I'm so proud of him being here. I promise to keep this short, and probably would want a Budweiser right now, but it's not here. So thank you again for coming tonight. It's a terrific honor to be inducted to the Lacrosse Hall of Fame with this great people. In closing, the best thing about lacrosse are friendships, and that's what I think tonight. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jim McDonald. Our next inductee this evening is Laurette Payette, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great contributor by her good friend and colleague, Laura Hebert.
I was a field hockey ref and they needed lacrosse officials, and Laurette was the queen of lacrosse in Ohio, and so if you wanted to get involved in lacrosse, somehow or another the road would take you to Laurette. And so people were badgering me about getting into lacrosse, and so I signed up and Laurette was the one who trained me. Had never seen the game, had never played the game, never ref the game, but was going to ref in this camp. And you know, she was very, "It's gonna be okay." And you know, I was terrible, but she never ever said, "God, you are the worst thing I've ever seen." She was just very, you know, positive and always willing to help you get better. And you know, through the years, everybody that you meet that knows Laurette, she likes to have, you know, it's family, friends, and fun in that order, and all of it revolves around lacrosse in some way, shape, or form. Well, the first thing you have to know about Laurette is, you know, she's not very tall. I think she might be 5'3". But when everybody meets her, you think she's 5'10", 5'11", and it takes you a few years to realize one day you're looking at her and you're like, "You're really short." But her presence is big. You know, she has a big presence on the field, she's a big personality, but it's always a positive, big presence. Part of lacrosse is that whole family atmosphere, and as an official and as part of being in the different organizations at different levels, you know, at the Cleveland level, at the state level, at the national level, she's built a great network of friends all over the country, and I think she continues to do that because family is so important, and she considers the friends that she's made through lacrosse to be her family.
And I also think, you know, she's a teacher at heart. I mean, she is a teacher at heart. And if you watch people ref, you can see the things that Lorette taught her that. You know, that's all Lorette. You know, how you stand on the field, how you place yourself, that's Lorette. And I think she enjoys that teaching piece, you know, always having an impact. I think she's one of those people that believes in those two words should be in the same sentence. You can't be a leader unless you're a servant leader. You know, and she feels the need to give back to a sport that I think she feels has given quite a bit to her in terms of all the relationships that she's built and, you know, the opportunities to travel, to meet people, to see great games, to witness great athletic contests. I think that we all believe that she's given so much to the game and so much to us individually, you know, as friends, as a mentor, that, you know, this is a perfect, it's perfect for her. And it's not, you know, it's not the end of her career. It's just, you know, an example of what a career like that means. Lorette, when you called and asked if I would be your presenter, I was as honored and as humbled as I've ever been in my entire life. Everybody in the lacrosse community knows your contributions to the game. And everybody also knows your contributions to them as individuals, not only as umpires or as members of committees, but as people. You've made us all better in the lacrosse community because of knowing you and because of being surrounded by your knowledge and your willingness to work and your servant leadership. We couldn't be more happy as a lacrosse community than to have you be a recipient of a National Hall of Fame nomination here at US Lacrosse, and we are all so very proud of you.
Oh, it's hard to get up and talk after that. Thanks, Matt, for being the MC tonight. Congratulations to all the inductees this evening, and those inductees that came before us. I'm honored and privileged to stand among you. It's quite an honor. Thank you, U.S. Lacrosse and Hall of Fame Committee, for this incredible honor. I'm truly humbled to be here tonight. When I got my notification call the weekend before Memorial Day, that's also the Division I quarterfinal weekend, I was driving, or I should say I was rushing from the Philadelphia airport to my officiating assignment at UPenn. And my phone was sitting there, obviously I had GPS on, and I saw the call was from 610, and that's the Philly area code, and I thought, oh my gosh, I better pick this up. What if it's somebody from UPenn? And I kept debating whether or not to answer it. Being from Ohio, I was going, oh, are you allowed to drive and talk on your cell phone in Pennsylvania? I don't know. And as I was processing what had just happened, I missed my exit. Thank goodness for GPS. I arrived on time, barely, as my presenter, Laura Hebert, would say, and this is one of her many mantras that we've all heard, early is on time is late. Thank you, Laura, for keeping it real. I'm sure this will add to the many opportunities you have taken to roast me through the years. With all sincerity, I'm just saying, you've all heard that before, I love and appreciate your honesty, your candor, your sense of humor, and most of all, your friendship. Thanks for being here with me and being my presenter. As I reflect on my truly great contributions for which I'm being inducted, I find that first and foremost in my mind is people, and Laura spoke about that. The people who help to make contributions possible. My family, my friends, my peers, my mentors, my role models, and yes, even those with whom I might be at odds. As an education conference presenter once said, those whom you find to be most challenging are your guardian angels. They force you to evaluate what you are doing and what is best for all at any given time. I want and need to thank so many. Family is first. Here with me tonight are two of my three younger sisters, Denise from Columbus, Ohio, and Renee from Leesburg, Virginia, both of whom have been women's lacrosse officials. Thank you for being here tonight and supporting your bossy older sister. My third sister, Carol, who hails from Columbus, Ohio, is preparing for the arrival of her first grandchild in Black Mountain, North Carolina. My two brothers, Robert Jr. and Kenny, and my father, Robert Sr., are cheering me on from Minnesota, and my mother, Margaret, is here with me in spirit. My mother and father instilled in all of us a work ethic. A job worth doing is worth doing to well, and I know they're both proud of all of us tonight. Thank you to my lacrosse family, and I think a lot of them are sitting right over here too. Those with whom I've officiated, worked on committees, taught clinics, presented at convention, shared so many memories, the Midwest officials, especially the Ohio crew, U.S. lacrosse staff, all of the work that we've done couldn't have been done without them, the NUC chairs, now known as the official subcommittee, and now no longer just the women, role models and mentors, many of whom are here tonight, the sisterhood of the traveling kilt, the third team on the field, the zebras. It has been an honor and privilege to work with all of you. Those who know me well know that I firmly believe it's all about the relationships. During my travels around more than half of the states in the country, you, my lacrosse family, have made your homes my home and welcomed me with open arms. I have so many places I love to visit, create memories, and share more than lacrosse, although lacrosse was the genesis of our relationships. My home in Cleveland is always open to you. I just wish Cleveland were a destination place like Baltimore. It is the North Coast. It's on Lake Erie. The Cuyahoga River no longer burns. We have the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. We have LeBron. Still not convinced. I have plenty of room, and I love to cook, and you know I'm always going to have chocolate. I find that my lacrosse journey started with me looking up to so many women whom I saw as role models and mentors, strong leaders involved in women's sports during the early years of Title IX. This year is the 45th anniversary of Title IX. And by the way, many of these women are being recognized by U.S. Lacrosse and IWLCA on October 21st. My lacrosse journey is winding down with me reflecting on that journey. And I'm trusting that I've been a strong leader, a mentor, and a role model for both women and men involved in women's sports, and specifically tonight, those in women's lacrosse. Last but certainly not least, I want to thank my best friend and my life partner, Connie, for her support for more than 30 years. Love you. Everyone, enjoy the celebration tonight.
One last round of applause for Laurette Payette. Our next inductee tonight is Casey Powell, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great player by his college coach, Hall of Fame member Roy Simmons Jr.
Carthage Lacrosse wanted preseason practice. They couldn't go outside at Carthage, so they came to Syracuse, where we had a synthetic field that had been plowed. I stopped to see what was going on, and I saw two players on the Carthage team that were really, really outstanding. One boy, a junior, the other a freshman. The junior was Casey. I was amazed at what I saw for a 16-year-old. He did everything a coach wanted. He had a lot of fantasy in him, not a lot of discipline, but a lot of success. And I thought, well, he's close to home. Maybe I got a shot at him. I'd never seen this much good raw talent in such a young boy. His eyes were great. We saw the field. He had a fabulous stick, a great speed, great strength, super endurance. He had everything you'd want in a lacrosse player at a very young age. to be top player in the country as an attackman, as a midfielder, as top player in the country, four-time All-American. But it was this unique style that everybody was well aware of. There's been nobody before or nobody after. That's the style of Casey. And so with all those accolades, and he got them in the box lacrosse later on, he got them in pro field game afterwards. He's given back to the game very unselfishly by having clinics and contests and demonstrations in South Florida, where he resides now. He's given back the game probably as much or not more than he gave the game. You know, everybody goes through your life, and those that you really love and you respect leave a footprint on your heart. And Casey's got footprints all over my heart, on and off the field. He's a gentleman, he's a competitor, he's a teacher, and he's a Hall of Famer. Well, Casey and I never shook hands. We always hugged. And when I heard you were in the Hall of Fame, there was no doubt in my mind. So congratulations, Casey, to the Zenith in lacrosse. You've earned it. You took a few hits for it, but you're to be congratulated for the highest honor we have in the world of lacrosse at the present time.
Thanks, Coach. My brothers and I have won a lot of rings, several rings, and anytime we won one, whether it's a national championship or a world championship, we kind of looked at it, we shut it, we sent it to our mother, and that's where all our rings are. I got this one tonight, and there's nothing better than this one, so I think I'll keep this one on for a while. Thank you to U.S. Lacrosse for this honor. It's unbelievable. Congratulations to Doug, a fierce competitor, and unbelievable playmaker, Coach Zimmerman, who I've watched for years, quite a leader of lacrosse, and Brooke Sweet, who was always excited about the game and a big hugger and a handshaker, so I always appreciate that. And it's great to hear the story of everybody else here that's being inducted. To my family and friends that have always been there for me, huge contingent, and thank you for being here to support me tonight. All the players and coaches who've inspired me throughout the years, a lot of them like Jay and Michael and Jesse and Vinny. It's great to have you here. It's overwhelming to understand how much lacrosse greatness is in this room right now. It's awesome to be here. My coaches from high school to pro, which I've played so many years, there's too many teams, but I will say that they have been the best in the game, especially my special tenure at Syracuse and the opportunity to play for my presenter, my coach, my friend, and my hero, Roy Simmons Jr. Thank you, Simi, for coming down on my behalf to Maryland, or as you used to call it, enemy territory. And being here to celebrate my induction with me tonight, you did so much more than coach lacrosse. You showed great belief in me. You dared me to wear number 22. You let me run free. You brought me to new places all over the country and the world, to Mexico, to England, Scotland, Wales. You brought me to museums and art galleries. You introduced me to classical music and people from so many backgrounds. You showed me life and how lacrosse is life. And I'm so thankful you opened up my world and helped me set my own course. Carthage, where I grew up, is a small town in an isolated area 90 miles north of Syracuse. The people from Syracuse call it the North Country, while people from Long Island call it Canada. There was no lacrosse heritage, not exactly what Doug Knight grew up in. One day in elementary school, our new gym teacher, Coach Venacracho, brought in a lacrosse stick. He passed it around. He said the sport was originated by Native American warriors, and the modern-day version of the game was a combination of all sports into one. Seemed right up our alley, and my brothers had the same lesson in their gym class that day. We went home that night and talked with excitement about lacrosse at the dinner table. A week later, my dad showed up with a couple sticks, first in town to have sticks. I've heard my dad say before that buying those two $50 sticks was the best investment he ever made. Well, I gave that some thought this week, and that's an understatement. Three full scholarships to Syracuse University. Dad, you're more like the Warren Buffett of lacrosse investment. You should have been a stockbroker. Once we got those sticks, we never put them down. We felt its magic. It brought our family together. wall ball, backyard games, creativity. We caught the attention of an old lacrosse coach named Mike Green, whom after hearing about us drove up to our house to watch us play in the backyard as he wanted us to join his lacrosse league. He said, "Mrs. Powell, your sons are going to be All-Americans." My mom said, "They are? What are All-Americans?" Well, he was right. Between high school and college, the Powell brothers were named All-American 17 times. Coach Venequatro started the program at Carthage Central, and I formally began my playing career as a freshman. Coach Fee would always say, "You're either in or you're out." Well, I was in. Our work ethic, our Carthage against the world mentality, and our all-in daily training routine led us to become very good very quickly. Thank you, Coach Venequatro, for introducing me to the sport, pushing me to be the best I can be, and always saying, "You're a Powell brother, you can do anything." Because in that statement, I believed you. After high school, my dream of playing for Coach Simmons became a reality. I got to play in the Dome for the legendary Syracuse program and wear number 22, worn by Hall of Famers Gary Gate and Charlie Lockwood before me. I had played with and against the best players in the world for 4 years while at Syracuse. Playing in four Final Fours and representing Syracuse was my dream come true. After my collegiate career ended, I started playing pro, drafted into the National Lacrosse League and an original pioneer of Major League Lacrosse. I played as long as I could in both leagues as well as internationally. I took what I learned from the start of my career and applied the same philosophy throughout, and that is come to play. I feel lucky to have played for so long. Looking back on it all, my greatest memories had little to do with the goals, the awards, or the games. What really sticks out are the people I've met, the places I've gone, and the wonderful experiences I've had. So thank you to lacrosse for this incredible journey. Quite simply, I could not have accomplished so much without my family, my wonderful parents, who I don't know if you knew what you're doing, but well played. You always let lacrosse be our thing. My sister Gretchen, who's my all-time number one fan, thanks for always standing up for us and fighting the other team's fans in the bleachers. My grandma Betty, my brothers Jason and Mason, and certainly my brothers Ryan and Mike, who could very well have their own chapter in this speech. It was most amazing following your careers and watching you both do what you did. I'm very proud of you both as players and, more importantly, men. The best times of my life were not playing under the lights at Carthage, the Dome, Bird Stadium, Pepsi Center, Madison Square Garden, or any other place. The best times were in the backyard, on the wall, and under the streetlights with you. We did it our way, and I share this honor with you both and promise to save you a seat right here next to me in the Hall of Fame. Heather, I'm glad lacrosse brought us together. Thank you for your partnership, your friendship, and your positive influence. You've done an amazing job leading the World Lacrosse Foundation. I'm excited to see what we can do moving forward. Of all the accomplishments I've ever had, the greatest is sitting right there in the front row. Her name is Bella. She was born in Canada during the 2006 World Championships while playing with my two brothers on my line. It was against Japan, so she cost me some points there. You've given me the green light to follow my passion, and I've played the best lacrosse with you in my life. Seeing you was always my favorite moment of any game. You made losing a bit easier and winning even better. May this Hall of Fame honor be a reminder to you that if you love something and you work hard, that anything is possible. Lastly, my professional playing career is now over, but my commitment to the game's growth is forever. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Casey Powell. The next inductee this evening is Jill Johnson Redfern, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great player by her Team USA teammate and friend, Hall of Fame member Kathleen Geiger.
My first meeting with her was matching up with me on the circle, start the game. You know, you always came together knowing that you're almost coming from similar backgrounds. We were from the same area, so the Philly part of it was there, and that led to our experience with the U.S. team. You know, Jill being a Philly player, me being a Philly player, you go to games together, you go to practices together, you know, you're trying out together all the time, but you're that Philly group. So Jill had great speed. She was tenacious. She was a very good defender. And I think a lot of that came from the love of the game, the excitement of the game was new to her. So you could feel that everything was new, but she was taking it all in and she was like a sponge. And she got better every time I came up against her. That's probably what makes her a great college coach now. She understood the game, but she had great coaches to help her, you know, keep adding to her, you know, her game and making her a better player. Well, you think back to the World Cup finals, you know, Jill scoring a goal, that isn't where I think her role was when we talk about what we do for our team. But if there was a ground ball to be had, it was Jill. If there was a girl to run down on the offensive end, it was Jill. She totally understood the team defense and, you know, she excelled whether she was leaving her girl or on her girl or getting a ground ball or, you know, stealing the ball from somebody. We talk now so much in the game of lacrosse about statistics. I think she did all the things to make a team successful, and you would never know it. And when you meet Jill, she's not going to talk about herself at all. But as a teammate, you wanted her on your team. You knew she had you covered. If you lost the ball, you knew Jill was going to slide in there and get it back for you. That part of the stuff, the workhorse part of the game, she was the midfielder that did all of that. She was the defender that stopped the ball. She is very calm all the time, and I think that's a strength on a team. You know, she's never real fired up. She's never down low. She's in a very even keel, and I think that led to her success. She didn't get riled up if we were in a situation where our back was against the wall or we were winning by a lot. You got the same from Jill. Jill, enjoy this evening. It'll go quickly and you'll be nervous, but it's well deserved. I hope that your family's enjoyed your trip down the lane of U.S. lacrosse and what a great job you've done with U.S. lacrosse, and you're being honored, and finally you're being honored as a defender, well deserved. As I see you tonight, I hope you take the time to smile and enjoy the moment.
Thank you, Kathleen, for those very kind words. Thank you, U.S. Lacrosse, for this tremendous honor. In choosing to recognize me, you have chosen to recognize the power of teammates. Teammates like Kathleen taught me the game. I am very proud to represent Ursinus College and all of the teammates there that I shared a field with. I am also proud to represent a World Cup team and all of those teammates who had also had an enormous impact on me as a player. In honoring me, U.S. Lacrosse, you have also chosen to acknowledge the power of potential. I learned the game of lacrosse when I went to college. I want to thank my college coaches, Betsy Ramsey and Anita DC, for embracing player development and teaching me what that can mean over the course of 4 years. I thank my U.S. coaches, Sue Stahl, Heather Dow, and Feffi Barnhill, for their dedication and influence on me. I also want to thank my husband, Tom, and my children, Cole and Cecily, for supporting my love of the game and my career in teaching the game. Thank you very much.
Jill Johnson Redfern, everyone. Our final inductee this evening is Brooke Sweet, being presented into the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame as a truly great player by his sister, Melissa Sweet.
I never remember a time when lacrosse wasn't important. I would have been 5. Brooksy was 8 when that happened, so and that's where it all started for my two brothers, Chris and Brooks, who both excellent players. It really was all a part of our life, all a family event. He was lightning fast, quick with the stick. I think part of that, he may laugh at this, I think part of that was the fact that he didn't really like to run a whole lot. I mean, he could run, he could move, but his game was more about finesse. When he had the ball, you either were expecting a quick pass or a goal. I'm telling you, that's the way it was. He would get himself positioned in a way that his defenders just couldn't keep up with him, and his other players loved him because all they had to do was find him and the ball was in the net. It was a thing of beauty. So when the World Games came along in 82, that was he was like a rock star. And we got to watch that. We got to witness that. It was the culmination of all of his play and everything that he'd ever done to get to this point. He was named Player of the World. I don't know how many people get named that in any sport. So, of course, it was magical for our family. You know, it's not just about what Brooksy did on the field. It's how he connected with everyone. Opposing teams loved him because they were so appreciative of the talent that he had. And so to see him being recognized on a world stage, we'd known it for years, to see that and to be a part of it, really, really huge. Brooks, first of all, I can't thank you enough for this amazing honor. I know how important this is to you. I know how important it is to me and the entire family. And I'm so filled with pride, not only for being asked to be the presenter for you, but also thank you for all the amazing memories and for making me feel like a rock star just being around you, to be able to watch you play, to see what you did for your teams, your teammates, your coaches. You know as much as I do that lacrosse in our family is synonymous with Dad. Dad is the one who started it. He played at Hamilton. He brought those sticks home for you and Chris. And I know he's looking down on us tonight. If he were here, he would tell you how absolutely proud he was. There's nothing more you could do to show your skills, to show what this game has meant to us and our family. You represent it for all of us. I love you more than anything, and I am so proud of you.
Wow. Thank you, Melissa. And Manoshevitz, as my old college coach used to say. I'd like to congratulate all the other inductees, and I'd like to say thank you to the U.S. Lacrosse Committee for selecting me for this great honor. I want to thank Lauren for helping out over the last month or two, my crazy emails and calls. Kira and Steny, you've been great over the years and everything you've done for this game. Whew, I better get going. I got a lot of people in my lacrosse life. So let's go back to the beginning. I grew up in a small town of Trumansburg, just outside Ithaca. It had 1,000 people and 2 lacrosse players, my younger brother Chris and myself. My dad, who played at Hamilton for 2 years, loved it so much that he bought Chris and I a stick when I was 8. My dad was great. He taught us how to catch. I'll get there. And throw. And for four years before we moved to Ithaca, we spent endless hours throwing a ball to each other and even more so against our barn wall. Without ever seeing the game, we had already developed the sidearm and the underarm passes and shots, which came in pretty handy upon moving to Ithaca, where they were just starting a lacrosse team at Ithaca High School. I joined the first JV team in 1971 and put my skills to work, being one of the top goal scorers each year on JV and varsity teams. My size was a bit of a disadvantage going against some of the bigger defensemen, but my quickness was developed due to my older brothers, Tim and Tripp, always chasing me to punch me after I'd hit them with the ball due to their inability to catch it. Well, that fancy footwork dodging their punches paid off pretty good down the road. My dad took me to many Cornell games growing up, so watching Richie Moran coach and seeing all the good and great Cornell players gave me a lot of incentive to keep getting better. Of course, I had a lot of good Ithaca players to watch. Also, Scotty Anderson, Frank Welch, just to name a few, who would coach me along the way as a young kid. My mom, God bless her, it took her a little longer to appreciate my passion for the game. She would always be kicking Chris and I out of the house for throwing the ball in the living room and the kitchen. Then we'd go outside, and 10 minutes later, she'd yell out the back door at us to stop hitting the house. And I'd look at her and say, "It wasn't me, Mom, it was Chris." She came around eventually, coming to a few high school games and even the 1982 World Games. I love you, Mom. I want to give a big thanks to all my great coaches. Baltimore's own Mickey Fenzel was my high school coach. Fred Acey at Farmingdale, one of my greatest coaches along the way. And I'll never forget one of his famous lines, because he was the boss out there and he let you know it. "Your ass is grass and I'm the lawnmower." And Manoshevitz, did I hear that many a times. Then I moved on to UMass after Farmingdale. And I got coached by Coach Garber. And he's one of the nicest people in the world. You know, he was a father figure, just a great guy. And loved playing for him and with all my UMass guys. That was just a great time. Now it was the World Games in 1982. Great coaches like Flatley and Urich and Willie Scroggs. Willie, I think I need to thank you the most for telling me halfway through the games, "Hey, Brooksy, why don't you start playing on the crease? Let O'Neill and Grebe and Darkey and Norman and all those other guys beat their guy and you'll be wide open." So I said, "Sure, Willie." And I can do that. And sure enough, I did it 7 times in the World Championship game, earning the game MVP and voted the player of the world. That was, you know, obviously the highlight of my career. Unfortunately, I didn't stop. I just kept playing club, and I still play today. It's, you know, it's all part of all the great people I've been around. So the World Games are over. I coached at Boston College a few years, lived in Australia for 4 years, and now started a 20-year career with SDX. At one of my first shows I attended, selling SDX, I met a sixth grade kid who I gave a lacrosse stick to. And 3 hours later, his mother, Ginny, who also worked at the show, came by to say thanks. Well, it was love at first sight. 4 years later, we got married. We have 2 awesome sons, PJ and Timmy. We soon had 2 beautiful daughters, Carly and Jamie. So the lacrosse fund just kept going. Watching PJ play for 4 years at Hofstra for Coach Danowski, watching and coaching my girls in Garden City, playing with my son PJ in Lake Placid, traveling to Vail in Australia with the whole family to enjoy the game and the atmosphere with lacrosse friends and families were just pure highlights for all of us. Ginny, I love you, and I thank you for being a great wife and a mother all these years. Lastly, I want to thank all my friends and family who attended tonight. My brother Tripp and Chris and my sister Melissa, you all helped me along the way in so many different ways. My great cousins from Boston, JJ and his wife Pam, my cousin Lori and Sarah, And Sarah, I gotta credit her a lot because the month or two before the World Games back in 82, she used to take me running all the time to get me in shape, that thing I didn't like to do. But she also practiced throwing the ball with me in the front yard, and she wasn't really that good. She wasn't a lacrosse player. So she threw the ball, and I had to scoop it up at my feet all the time. And, you know, I guess it paid off, because if you go back to the championship game, the first goal I scored was a pass to me, got deflected. I scooped it up off the thing, jumped up, and scored. So, Sarah, thank you. My Farmingdale buddy, John Sullivan, one of the best stoppers in the game. Thanks, John. My Ithaca buddies, Mikey B., Coho, Danny, Scotty Anderson, you know, you've just been great friends over the years, and, you know, I love you for that. All my UMass boys, Harry O., Schmitzy, Mickey, Mike Letera, Norman, Lenny, PK just showed up, holy smokes, and any other UMass guys that snuck in. My UMass teammates and good friends, Mike O'Neill, Finney Sombrato, Mark Greenberg, Searsy and Raider, I saw you guys too. Jimmy Burke, you know, you guys, it was just so great playing with you guys, and, you know, it was easy. It was easy to play with you guys. You made me look good. You know, and then my Florida, Vail, Australia World Games buds, Fritzy and his wife Melissa, Mickey, Gary, Denty, and Leslie, Mikey O., and I'm sure there's a few more I forgot to write down, but, you know, and lastly, it's my family. Ginny for putting up with me all these years through the highs and the lows. PJ and my beautiful granddaughters, Cameron and Gracie. My two beautiful daughters, Carly and Jamie, are the loves of my life. And lastly, my dad and mom, my brother Tim, and Uncle Harry. Whew. Up in heaven, thank you for all your love and support over the years. God bless and good night.
One last round of applause for Brooke Sweet. And once more for the National Lacrosse Hall of Fame, class of 2017. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes tonight's formal ceremony, but the evening is not over. The induction celebration is only beginning. Food and drink will be served downstairs until 10:30 p.m. Before going downstairs, will all current Hall of Famers, as well as the newest inductees, please gather up here on the stage for a group photo. Thank you. And to all others, we thank you for coming and hope that you enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you.